So we are going to wrap up a series that we've been on. This will be the fifth week that we've been preaching on what's in your oikos, engaging our sphere of influences for Jesus' sake. You've heard the word oikos probably more times than you care to count at this point, but it's been a word that we have used to define the phrase engaging our sphere of influence. Oikos is a Greek word that was used, especially in Cornelius' household, to describe a household. It was that was not only the immediate family, but it would be perhaps the slaves, and it would be the people that lived on the property, the nearest neighbors, that kind of thing. Call them all together, that would be an oikos. And so we are using that word to describe what our sphere of influence is. And so I will try to not say oikos anymore today. I'm not promising that. Yeah, you know that ain't going to work. I'm not promising that. I am not promising that we will never use the word oikos again down the road, but we will try to, don't say never. That's a big word right there. So with that. So if you have your Bibles, you can get them open to Acts chapter 11. And I just want to walk with you through where we've been in this series up to this point. I kicked it off about 4 weeks ago with Acts 10. We went back and visited Cornelius' house, and the title of the sermon there was What's in Your Oikos? You Might Just Be Surprised. That was the subtitle. And the whole point was that Peter had an encounter with the Lord. He had a vision from the Lord about who he was supposed to go and share with, and it was Gentiles. And that kind of rocked Peter's world because Jews didn't associate with Gentiles. And so Peter sees all this, and he has a little argument with God. God wins, and everything's good, and he goes and ministers to Cornelius, and Cornelius and his whole household come to the Lord. And in that, we see that there was prayer involved. We see that there was the nudging of God involved, and we see that there were some wrong assumptions that God had to correct in Peter's life about Gentiles, and ultimately God goes on to correct wrong assumptions later in the church about Gentiles and everything else as well. And Pastor Rich took us in the next three sermons and that, pressing deeper into what is the first thing that needs to be first when we think about engaging our sphere of influence. And that needed to be prayer. Prayer needed to be that needs to be the first thing. That needs to be right at the top. That we need to be praying about the people around us, how God would want us to invest in their lives, to come alongside them, to share with them. What is it that God is calling us to do with those people around us? Just not ignoring them. God has put you and I here on earth for a reason, and that reason primarily is this: to proclaim his excellencies with those people around us. It's stated in Scripture several different ways, but that really is the bottom line, to share the good news, the fact that Christ has saved us, that he has redeemed us. And we tell our stories with that, how God has done that, and it's awesome what the Holy Spirit does with that. And so we pray over that, and that's the first thing. And then the second thing that Pastor Rich challenged us on was about God nudging us. Where is it that God's tapping us on the shoulder and saying, hey, I want you to speak into this person's life. I want you to come alongside that person and your neighbor or your coworker or whoever it is out there and be sensitive and open to that. And it's much what Peter had to do with Cornelius, and Cornelius had to do with Peter. Be sensitive and obedient to doing what the Lord told Cornelius to do and going and sending for Peter. And then there was the whole issue of wrong assumptions, that we can make wrong assumptions about where God is at work, and we think, oh, God's never going to work in those people's lives. I mean, my goodness, they're so far down the road, they're never going to be rescued by God. And what we learn in that is nobody is beyond the saving reach of God. No one. Everyone can be saved and come to the knowledge of repentance. As a matter of fact, that is God's desire. Titus 2:11 tells us that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. And God desires all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of repentance. And so he wants to use us in that mission, which is just an awesome thing in itself. Yeah, and so it brings us to this point of the message that I want to share with you today out of Acts 11. Those first four messages were primarily about our individual oikos, our individual spheres of influence. We talked about what is my sphere of influence, how do I need to go, what do I need to do? But there is another dimension of our sphere of influence, and that is the church's sphere of influence, and that's what I want to talk to you about this morning, and I find this in Acts 11. The church and its oikos, it's bigger than you may think. And we often think about, when we start thinking about sphere of influence, sometimes we may get kind of tunnel visioned on it being kind of geographical or maybe just in our neighborhood. We don't think about maybe God is doing something bigger than that with us. And we may never stop to realize exactly what he does with some of the little things. I want to explore that with you this morning. That it may just be bigger than you think. So if you have your Bibles, let's start this little journey in Acts 11, and let's read verses 19 through 21 here. Now those who had been scattered by the persecution in connection with Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, telling the message only to Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. This narrative Luke picks up right here after the stoning of Stephen. He is saying that Stephen is stoned, and what happened as a result of that is people began to spread out from Jerusalem because of the persecution that was there. Now, you remember what Jesus said in Acts 1:8? He said, right to his disciples, just before he ascended, he says, wait until you receive power from on high, and then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. But he didn't stop there at Jerusalem. He said, and Judea, and Samaria, and to the whole world, the uttermost parts of the earth, depending on your translation, to every people group. This begins that movement. Up until this point, the church is just huddled in Jerusalem. Stephen is martyred, and the church scatters, and they take the gospel with them throughout Judea, throughout Samaria, into the Decapolis, up into Africa, and all throughout the Roman world. And so here are some men, we read here, that they make their way to this city in Antioch, Syria. It's up in the northern part of Syria up there, and They some of them are only first speaking to Jews only. Now, Antioch of Syria was the third largest city probably in the Roman Empire at the time. It had a population of about 300,000. That doesn't sound maybe like a huge population to you when you think about the population of New York City or Los Angeles or something like that today, where you've got, what, 1.5 million people or whatever it is that live in those regions. But 600,000, depending on your estimates, is still a lot of people to be in a small area in a town in this time. Antioch was not necessarily as big as Reading, for that matter, but it was a lot of people in a small area. But of this 300,000, we'll call it 300,000 people, of this 300,000 people that lived in Antioch, probably only about 60,000 of them were Jews. The rest were Gentiles. And so if you're only speaking to the Jews, you're only speaking to a small percentage of the population there. And these others were moved by God to come and speak to the rest of the Gentiles, the rest of the population, the Gentile population of Antioch, about the Lord. And so God is tapping them on the shoulder and leading them in there for that. And the other thing I notice about these men that are called in here, they're unnamed. We don't know who these guys are. We have no clue. It's not Peter. It's not Paul. It's not these big names. It's not anybody listed in Hebrews chapter 11 in the Hall of Faith chapter. So who are these guys? We don't know. They seem to be ordinary men that God just nudged and moved and said, go here and share, and they did. They didn't have MDiv degrees from the seminary. They were just obedient to what the Lord wanted to do with them. Now, what kind of environment were these guys walking into? Antioch was not your most receptive city to the gospel at the time. It was full of pagan worship. It was full of immorality. It was a trade center, and so anything that was helpful in the growth of the trade and in making money was acceptable. And so that led to all kinds of licentiousness and things. And now here come these guys preaching Jesus, and they are different. They are preaching a message that's never been heard before, and they are living a life that apparently appears to be different. It's a group of guys, and probably women as well, that were church. They were the called out ones. That's what the word church means, ecclesia, which means called out ones. And so they were called out by God to go into this region and preach the word, which they did. The ordinary Christians that God used. And this is the first place in the New Testament that Christians are called Christians. It occurs a couple verses later in verse 26 of Acts 11, but I want to mention it here. Because the actual term Christian means those belonging to the party of Christ. Those belonging to the party of Christ. It was meant, well, let me back up. It was probably a term that was not, that the Christians themselves did not label themselves as. It was probably put on them by the residents of Antioch. They saw these weird people doing weird things, living a weird lifestyle that they had no clue about. And so they called them Christians and was meant probably to be a derogatory term, but they embraced it to be something positive. And it's much like the day back when I was in high school, and after I just came to know Jesus in my junior year in high school, I was on fire for the Lord, and me and a group of guys hung out, some of those guys I shared with you about 4 weeks ago. We were on the campus there, we were sharing Christ, and we were a little different at that way. And people, the word they had for us, the phrase they had for us then, they called us Jesus freaks. And we were okay with that. That's fine. I mean, hey, I don't mind being called a freak. Works for me. And so we were all good with that. But it was, they meant it as a derogatory term, and we embraced it as something positive. Because it identified us with Christ. Now, we were trying to stay humble through all that as well. So I want you to get this picture, like, you know, we were thinking, oh, you know, we're so great and Jesus, you know, kind of thing. We were trying to stay humble through that too. And so it was probably a name that was given to them by the populace in Antioch. And it says that as they continued to share this with these people in the midst of this weird place, that great numbers turned to the Lord. Just because of their story. Great numbers turned to the Lord. The Lord was using their story. Ordinary, unschooled men probably, and women, telling their story. God was turning great numbers to them. They were open. They were willing. They were willing to go and plant a seed of the gospel in a place where there was no seed of the gospel. And so that brings me to the first dynamic I find about the church and its oikos. What should we be considering as a church family, as a TAC family? What should we be considering that is our sphere of influence? We know about our individual spheres of influence, but what about our familial sphere of influence as a family here at Trinity? And this is the first dynamic I think we need to do, is the dynamic of planting seed. The dynamic of planting seed. See, when I read this story and I go on to read more about what Antioch, and I follow the transformation and acts of Antioch, Antioch becomes a city that becomes Paul's launching base for his missionary journeys. It becomes the church that he works out of. What I see happening in Antioch is a transformation of that city. I see it changing in ways, and there is something very real happening there because of the fact that people are sharing their stories. And this is what we see when we continue to go through Scripture. We see as the gospel goes into places, there is transformation, there is change. Where there was lawlessness, there becomes some guidance of law. Where there's immorality, there becomes some morality. Where there is lying and cheating, there becomes less of that. It's not all that different today either. This is a picture of our middle son, Michael, at a swearing-in ceremony when he was hired by the Butte County Sheriff's Department about 3 years ago. And yeah, he did have some fun here a couple weeks ago, had to go around knock on doors and tell people to ask people to leave their homes because the Oroville Dam might give way. Lord willing, that, praise the Lord, that did not happen. Nothing, he didn't have any weird stories about that. But about 3-4 months ago, I was doing a ride-along with him, and he was patrolling the southern Oroville area, which is one of the more high crime-ridden areas of Butte County. And he liked working in that area. And so we were, at night, we were in this one area, which of the crime area was where the most intense crimes were occurring. And it was about a 10-block area where we were going around this one night, and I counted about 6 churches in this 10-block area where crime was pretty high. And I asked him if he knew anything about the churches there, and he said, yeah, I know some of all the churches. And from what he understood about them and things, that all the churches were Bible-believing, Christ-centered churches there, those 6 that I was speaking of. And I said, do you know anything about what kind of presence do these churches have in the community? Are they involved at all in their community? And he says, well, yeah, sometimes they are. And right now they're not. They're not really involved in the community. I mean, they're there in the community meeting, but they're not reaching out to community. And so I was interested, and I said, do you know what happens when the churches were involved, and whether just a single church involved in the community or they partnered together, which happened too. They partnered together at times to get involved in the community. Do you know what happens to the crime right at that point during those times when the church is involved in the community? He says, oh yeah, when the churches get involved in the community and they make their presence out there and get outside their walls, the crime rate goes down. It doesn't go away, but it goes down. And then this time the churches had pulled back for whatever reason, some dysfunction or something happened, and they had pulled back from the community bit and the crime rate went back up. You see, when the gospel shines into the dark places, the dark doesn't overcome it. And that's what was happening here in Oregon. In those places, there was a respite where the churches were active. They were going in, they were planting seed, they were telling their stories, they were getting involved in their community, and the gospel was preached both in word and deed, and it made an effect on the lives of the people there. This is what it says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 14 through 16. This is what Paul is admonishing the church in Philippi to do, and ultimately us, when he says this: do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. This is the part I want you to get. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. Some versions say as you hold out the word of life. The point is, as we put forth the gospel, as we hold that out, as we share the story, we shine like stars because we're shining Christ, that people would see Jesus. And that's what God's mission is for us, that people would see Jesus. Here's another one, coming from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. That's our mission, to declare his praises. You don't have to have a theology degree to that. Just tell your story. How has God touched you? How has he rescued you? How has he shined his light in you? Share that. So we go into a place where there is no presence. So what, for Trinity Alliance family, what does that mean for us? Well, we have a presence in some places right now where we're doing that. One of them is the Bella Vista School Ministry we have that Darcy coordinates and others work with her on. They go down to the school, and once a month that they are feeding the staff and teachers there at Bella Vista. It's a ministry of presence, what I call it. And it's just speaking into these people's lives by an act of kindness and grace. And then when the opportunity comes up, sharing a story, just being open to that, being open to the nudge of God in that. There's also the presence of our yard sale. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that later. But, you know, we get calls about 3 or 4 months ahead of time. Are you having the church yard sale? When is the church yard sale going to be? And then they're all nervous. We're not going to have the church yard sale this year. People in the community are ready for this thing. And it's made a presence. And you, if you've never been to the church yard sale, you need to come. There's a lot of neat things that happen here, the prayer times and just the interaction and things that people and the witness and testimony that go on. Now, as I share all these wonderful things that we're doing, let me say we need to stay humble, people, okay? We need to not get full of ourselves because God still has places and things he wants us to go and do. We have not arrived, not by any stretch of the imagination. But I also want us to celebrate what God is doing through us as well. So we need to stay humble, but we celebrate too. There is another ministry at Bella Vista School that was amazing, and I'm going to just show it to you rather than tell you about it. I saw them when you came in the door, but back here in the lobby, there is the youth board that is there. And on that youth board are several thank you letters, like the one Becky was holding up in the video there. And, you know, it's on that paper, like she was saying. You remember writing on that paper and you had to do that penmanship, you know, that line, that little dotted lines? I hated that time. I didn't learn anything from it. I can't write anything on that stuff. But anyway, there's a bunch of those thank you notes out there with that. And you know, that was a family effort, guys. That, from the socks that you all provided for that, to the kids being involved, go down there and distribute the socks and make those contact down there in the schools, that's a ministry of proclamation. That's a ministry of presence. That's what we're talking about, planting seed here, looking for those kind of opportunities. And the ministry of proclamation, the ministry of presence, is not always about what we say, as much about what we do. You see, St. Francis of Assisi, I think, said it best when he said this. He said, preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words. Right? Colossians 3:17 says, and whatever you do in word and deed, or deed, depending on the translation, do all to the glory of God. That has to be our overriding purpose for any of this we do. It's for God's glory, not our glory. If we never get acknowledged in the ministry of presence and planting seed and these other dynamics to tell you about, hey, that's okay, because it's for God's glory, not us. We need to keep that in mind. That's how we stay humble, right there. So those are a couple examples of the ministry of planting seed that we have here at the church. My question to us is what other opportunities that God may be tapping us on the shoulder with as a church family that we can press into in our community and be sensitive to and minister through that aspect? Make sense? You with me there? Got that? Okay. So it's the idea of being obedient, open vessels, not content to just be on the church property, not content to just come on and be within the property lines here and saying, we're good, we're a church, that's great, and not have any concern and influence and impact on the community. I can tell you from firsthand, being involved in this community and some of the things that I'm involved with here, that people recognize us. They recognize what we do, but they more than that, what they recognize, there is something going on inside of them that it's bigger than us. There's something going on inside of them that it's about God. That's my paraphrase of what they're trying to say. And it's about Jesus. They're seeing it. And it's just beginning to really take hold here. So where else does God want us to do this? We as a family need to continue to be praying about that. That leads me to the second dynamic I want to share with you that I find in this passage. So not only do we have the dynamic of planting seed, but we have the dynamic of watering seed. This is the dynamic of nurturing and helping something grow up. And we find this in Acts chapter 11, verses 22 through 26, when Luke writes this for us. Now, news of this reached the ears of the church of Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. So what was happening in Antioch and all the people coming to the Lord had reached Jerusalem. When he arrived and saw the evidence of the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. That's the second time Luke says that. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. So what's going on here? People in Jerusalem hear something's going on down in Antioch. And they're like, we need to go check this out. We need to see what's happening. So they figure out how they're going to do this. They're not going to try to correct them or anything else. They just want to know, here's a movement of God. Something's going on. They already know that the door has been opened for the Gentiles, because if you go back in the verses 1 through 18 of chapter 11, you read about Peter sharing his testimony with the Jerusalem church about how God had opened the door to the Gentiles. So the Jerusalem church was already aware that God had opened the door to the Gentiles. That wasn't the question. The question was, is this church okay? Do they have enough resources? Do they need help? What is it that God wants us to do to encourage them, if anything? How do we do this? And so they look among their people and they choose a man named Barnabas, whose very name means encouragement, literally son of encouragement is his name. And he's described here in the passage for us. Luke describes him as a good man. It means that he was a man of integrity. He was a man of honesty. He was a man of fairness. He was a man full of the Holy Spirit. That's kind of important. If you're going to go and go on this mission, you need to be full of the Holy Spirit. It means that he wasn't control of him. He wasn't in control. It was God in control. He was in submission to the Holy Spirit's leading and empowerment, the power and presence of God in his life here. And he was full of faith as well. That to go and do what God wanted him to do, he's going to trust God to follow through on his promises. If God said he was going to do it, it was going to happen. And Barnabas was this kind of man, apparently. And so he was the one that they chose to go down to Antioch and see what's going on. And it says when he got there, he was happy with what he saw. He saw that these brothers and sisters in Christ were staying true to the truth of God's word. They were staying true to those teachings of Jesus. They were staying true to those things that were on the narrow path, that were pointing people to Jesus. And so he just continues to encourage them to stay true to that, to not waver from that. It's about where a church that was mature sees a church that is young and growing and says, how can we go and help them? How can we water them? How can we nourish them? How can we help them grow up in things? What is it that God wants us to do here? That's what this dynamic is about. And he sees the work that has to be done here. Barnabas does. And he's, I got a feeling he looked at that and go, this is a big job. And he probably got a nudge from God, is you need some help. And so he goes over to Tarsus, which is about 100 miles away, and he gets Paul. Now, Paul's conversion happened about 3 or 4 years earlier than this. We haven't heard from Paul for a while. He's been off over there in Tarsus because, well, frankly, once you were a Pharisee and you were at the top of your class and then you become a Christian, that's not going to work well for you. So he had to go hide out for a while in Tarsus and things. And so Barnabas goes and gets him and brings him back over, and they spend a year here in Antioch helping those believers grow up, helping them become more mature and complete, helping them to be all that God has wanted them to be. And that is that dynamic of watering. We have examples of this that we do. This is about a more mature church taking and going in a physical presence, sending people to go and nurture and help and encourage another church. Our Belize team does that. When you guys go off, you're going to another church there in Belize, and you're coming alongside them, and you're helping them, and you're equipping them and doing the different things there that God would have you do there. And you're sent, yes, we help out with the financial parts and prayers and different things. You guys went 2 years ago just as a family, correct? And then last year you took a team from here, and that team is bigger this year that's going. Our youth are part of it. And so these are the kind of presence and things that we can have. We can go into short-term mission opportunities and look for those. Where's God tap us on the shoulder and say, hey, you guys are mature, and I want to use you to encourage this body of believers here. Maybe it's across town. Maybe it's in Belize. Maybe it's in Mexicali. Maybe it's in France. Maybe it's in Anderson. I don't know. But it's all these places that we be open to about where is it that God wants us to go to encourage other believers and help them grow up, to nourish them, to water them with the word. What is it that God wants us to do? Again, staying humble. You know, oh, we're here to help you. We're going to set you straight. We're losing it when we do that. We need to stay humble. This is God using us. We're vessels. We're not super saints. We're just vessels. We stay humble. The rescue mission is another opportunity there. You've got a chance. If that's something God's having you on the shoulder with, that's something that we can partner with as a church family to support our rescue mission. They do a wonderful work here, and you heard some of that from Larry last week. I mentioned short-term mission trips. What else does God want the TAC family to water? What else does he want us to water? And your answers are as good as mine. We just seek the Lord with that and see what he throws our way. What is it that he's pressing in on our hearts with that we need to press into? Well, there's one more dynamic about the church and its oikos that I find in this passage in Acts 11, and it's this. The dynamic of sending seed. This is deals with the financial material things that we can send. Not so much people. Sometimes two and three go hand in hand. And that should be a three and not a two. But there you go. You can figure that out. So it is the dynamic of sending seed. What is it that we can send over? And here's what we see happening in Acts. This is where I get this one. Verse 27. During this time, some prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them was named Agabus. And he stood up and through the Spirit predicted that a severe famine would spread over the entire Roman world. This happened during the reign of Claudius. The disciples, each according to his ability, decided to provide help for the brothers living in Judea. This they did, sending their gift to the elders by Barnabas and Saul. So now, what's going on here? First of all, there are some people that come from Jerusalem, because the Jerusalem church continues to send people down to Antioch to help with the work and things that are going on there. Apparently, in this one group that came, Agabus was one of the people there. He has a prophecy about a famine that's coming. And by the way, this famine did happen. It happened in about 45, 46 AD. So anywhere from about 6 months to a year prior to this event Luke records right here, this event occurs about 6 months or a year prior to the actual famine. So it makes sense the famine's about a year later. And Josephus and other church historians record this incident for us. And it did spread throughout the whole Roman world, but in particular, the region of Judea and Jerusalem itself got hit the hardest with this famine. And so, because of the prophecy that was done here, the brothers and sisters in Christ at Antioch, they begin to say, hey, we need, God is pressing on our hearts to help our brothers and sisters in Christ, the church that came to us in our time of need of watering. We need to help them by sending some seed to help them get through this famine. Because we'll be better off than they will. So it says that each ability, they took up an offering and then they were going to send it later by Barnabas and Saul to the church in Jerusalem. You see what happened here? The mature church saw the need of the younger church that was growing up, sent some people in need to it. Now the younger church has taken on the same convictions and they turn it back around and say, we're going to help the more mature church. God moves that way. He spreads that around and brings those things together, so that each is working together. That was part of their influence. That was what they could do. The church responds and they send them an offering. What are some examples of this that we as a church can do in sending seed? Well, we do that when you give offerings to the Great Commission Fund here at Trinity Lions. That money all goes to the headquarters office in Colorado Springs. And from there, they take all that money and they partition it out to the different mission fields as the needs are. every dollar of it goes into the mission field. And they are able to help equip them and give them the resources and things that they need to continue the work of making disciples and sharing the gospel. Planting seed where there is no seed presence. Watering seed where there is already seed presence. And that dollar that we start right here can end up clear across affecting somebody in Asia, in some of the more creative access countries. That's how far a church's influence can extend. It's global. It can be global. The shoebox ministry we do at Christmas time, we give the Samaritan's purse. Those things go all over the world. And the notes that you put in your shoeboxes for whatever boy and girl gets it, you don't know the impact that that's going to make. But they often make a tremendous impact on your story after story with that. Again, a little act of kindness here in sending something can make a whole world of a difference, literally, a world away. It's being sensitive to those needs around us. When we do our yard sale collects a lot of money. It all goes to missions. And all that money gets partitioned out and goes to the various mission fields to help those men and women on the field and their directors and whatnot to be able to do the work that they've been called to do. And so you guys bring items to this thing, and you may think, well, this item doesn't have any significance to me, I'll just sell it at the yard sale. But that item that gets sold turns into dollars that goes seed to the field to equip and empower people to share the gospel. I guess that's where the saying, one person's junk is another person's treasure, I suppose. But that's what happens with that. There is another opportunity that we have done. We have, in the past, we've taken up an offering for the Arabic Learning Center down in Sacramento. You guys remember that. A couple years ago, we did that. And they had some needs to where they were going to be getting some printed materials and things to disciple some people there and whatnot. And I believe some yard sale funds matched that. And we sent them a pretty significant gift down there. And it blessed them tremendously. I had the privilege this last week when I was down in Encounter, the district conference down there, to connect up with Pastor Aid, who is the pastor of the Arabic Learning Center there. And it was great to hear his heart and things, and there's something we've been praying through and looking for an opportunity to partner with them some more. And I'm going to ask Jim Harney to come and share with us more about this. This is, as you know, we've had missions moments once a month, and this is part of that. And missions moment is a time for us to share with you what God is doing in the various mission fields around the Alliance, and for us to be aware of what we need to pray for, how we might partner in one of these areas that I'm sharing with you this morning, and things like that. So Jim, why don't you come and share with us? So the question comes to us, where does God want us as a TAC family to send seed? That's something we need to be in prayer about. I trust that you will do that. When it comes to all three of these things, planting seed, watering, sending seed, we need to be committing this to prayer. Yes, we have our individual spheres of influence that we each need to be searching and seeking God for and asking Him where He wants us to go and touch shoulders with and shine the light of Christ. But we also have a sphere of influence as a church family. It goes outside and beyond the property lines of this church. We used to have a sign that was above the door of the church here years ago. And I don't know why we ever took it down. But it said, caution, you are now entering the mission field. And that's what happens when you leave here. It's so easy for us to get caught up into our daily routines, our daily lives, and the rituals and things that go on. And yes, we have to raise families, and we need to work in our jobs, and we need to do the things that are there. But all of those serve a greater purpose. They serve a purpose to minister for Christ. And those spheres of influence where we are. Your job, your community, your home, your school. Driving down the highway can be a testimony to what happens out there. Especially when you have those bumper stickers on your car. Think about it. So there will be opportunities coming up. I just ask you to be in prayer. So this is your take-home question. Where does God want us as a TAC family to plant, water, and send seed? There's some questions in your outlines, was in your bulletin for your connection group notes or individual study. I want to encourage you and your connection groups to wrestle with these a little bit. Maybe God will just reveal some things where we can step out together as a family and make more of an impact in our community, in our state, our country, and our world. That's just how big our Oikos is. Let's pray.